Omaha's news leader, chronicling the stories and people making a difference in our community. This is KETV NewsWatch 7's Chronicle.
And good morning, I'm John Oakey. The November election, less than 3 weeks away, we're devoting all our chronicles between now and then to that crucial vote as part of our year-long commitment to covering the issues and candidates running in 2018. And this morning, focusing on the U.S. Senate race. It began with 10 candidates hoping to represent you, now down to just three. Incumbent Republican Deb Fischer, Democrat Jane Raybould, and Libertarian Jim Schultz. We talked with both Schultz and Raybould, and those interviews are online on KETV.com right now. And joining me this morning is the incumbent Republican Senator Deb Fischer. Thanks for coming in. We appreciate it.
Thank you, John. Great to be here.
We appreciate again your time. So, first 7 years or so, what's been maybe one of the most surprising things or something maybe you did not expect in your first term?
Oh, I think maybe just trying to work in a two-house, a bicameral system. I came from the Nebraska legislature, where you worked with 49 people. When the United States Senate, you need to work with 100 people first off, and Republicans and Democrats, and we're organized that way. And I promised Nebraskans 6 years ago I was going to reach across the aisle and establish relationships with Republicans and Democrats and get things done, and I've done that.
And so why seek re-election?
There's still work to do. You know, we've gotten a lot of things done. We've cut taxes. We're rebuilding the military. I passed a paid family leave program, but we still need to get more done. For example, we need to look at infrastructure. That's something that I was really proud to work on in the state of Nebraska, and I've worked on it in the Senate, too. But we need to take a lot of different segments of infrastructure, whether it's roads, pipelines, airports, broadband, transmission lines. There is a whole swath of infrastructure that needs to be addressed in this country, and I'm excited to get to work on it.
So where does Nebraska rank in infrastructure right now? Where do they rank in infrastructure right now, just based on looking nationally?
Well, I think we're doing pretty well when it comes to our roads. That was a big bill, a big policy change that I worked on in the legislature. We've worked on that in the Senate as well. We passed the FAST Act, which was the first really reauthorization of federal highway spending in many, many years. Brought back $1.5 billion to the state of Nebraska. That's going to help with our roads and bridges. And part of what I really am focused on now is broadband, and I've been able to work on that with my committee on Commerce Committee and also on the Ag Committee. Senator Klobuchar, who's a Democrat from Minnesota, she and I serve on both those committees together, and we were able to get a piece in the Farm Bill now that's going to offer grants to states to be able to deploy more broadband in rural areas. That's huge. That's going to make a difference for our entire state to have that connectivity out there that's going to continue to drive our economy.
Yeah, obviously a lot of rural areas here in Nebraska, so that's a pretty big deal. So where do we stand right now in trying to make that happen and maybe get more access for people, you know, out west?
Yeah, well, we're working on it all the time. You know, Senator Klobuchar comes from Minnesota. That's a pretty big state. But to be able to have broadband deployed across the entire state, also in urban areas where there's pockets where you don't have that access to that connectivity, that limits what you can do. What you can do as an entrepreneur, what we can do as a state. So to be able to have that connection, it just offers up so much innovation. You know, I'm one of the leaders when it comes to the Internet of Things, and that's all that cool stuff out there with technology that I am probably never going to use, but for sure my grandchildren are. And it's going to be able to be available for any type of business. Just recently, I was at Northeast Community College and took a tour of their precision ag program that they have there. Right now, agriculture is the third largest user of the Internet of Things. Can you imagine if we had broadband deployment in rural areas, what that would mean? We'd see the economy of this state just boom. And it would help. It would help people to stay in their own homes because you'd be able to have telehealth services. Think of what it would do for education and to be able to offer different classes, expand a curriculum all across the state. There are so many exciting possibilities that I want to continue to work on that broadband deployment and make sure we get it done for the people of this state.
Let's talk about some of the issues. Jane Raybould calls you a senator for sale. She's created a website. She alleges that you've taken $1.5 million in campaign donations from political action committees. What do you have to say to that?
I have support from all across the state of Nebraska, and I've earned that support. I've traveled hundreds of miles, tens of thousands of miles, and meet with Nebraskans all the time. I have Democrats who are my county chairmen. I have Republicans. I have independents. I have received absolutely wonderful endorsements from the Nebraska Hospital Association, from the Omaha and Lincoln firefighters, Nebraska Farm Bureau, Nebraska Cattlemen, many, many organizations across this state. I think that's, you know, when opponents make attacks like that, it's a distraction. And Nebraskans want to hear us talk about the issues. So I'm going to continue to talk about the issues.
And OpenSecrets.com claims that 45% of your donations are from PACs. You look at some other people who are around the area. Ben Sass is about 22%. Joni Ernst, 13%. Grassley's 32%. So how do you react to that, that your numbers seemed a little bit higher than maybe some of the other elected leaders around Nebraska and Iowa?
Yeah, I'm in an election cycle. Mm-hmm. My colleagues from that you mentioned, they're not in an election cycle right now. And I think it's really a false narrative that my opponent puts out there. She's taking PAC money, but she says she doesn't. But she takes PAC money. And that comes about from different leadership PACs, from Elizabeth Warren and Chuck Schumer, who also receive PAC money from different groups, different corporations. And then they, I guess you could say, they kind of launder it and they pass it on to candidates like my opponent. So to say she doesn't take it, I don't think that's being completely honest with people.
Okay. Senator Ben Sass has introduced a package of ethical reform measures, among them no donations from foreign sources, presidential candidates have to release tax returns, public database of congressional settlements, no stock trading for Congress, no revolving door to lobbyist firms. Do you support any of these measures, all these measures?
Yeah, I have no problem with any of them. You know, we don't take any kind of money from foreign sources right now. That doesn't happen. I think reporting and transparency is always the best way to go.
And tax reforms, your tax returns, have you made those published yet?
No.
Published those yet? Are you planning on doing that?
I do not. And Senator Sass, if you look at his reforms that he's proposing, his proposal deals with president and vice presidential candidates.
You feel that's nothing you need to do? You don't need to worry about doing that?
I file financial disclosure forms every single year with the Senate Ethics Committee as well as the FEC. And I've never had any questions raised on any of my forms.
We've had to push this interview back a few times because of the Brett Kavanaugh. Why did you vote for his nomination?
He's qualified for the position, and he has given over 300 opinions. 200 of those were controlling opinions, and he had 15 where the language in Supreme Court decisions, the language from his opinion was basically lifted and put into the Supreme Court decision. He's very qualified. What we saw, and I know you're probably referring to, is that last hearing that took place with Dr. Ford stepping forward. We did another FBI investigation, waited to see what came out of that. That was the seventh FBI investigation. There was no corroboration from Professor Ford's witnesses who she had named. They all said that they did not remember any such party. One of her longtime friends, she even said that she had never met Brett Kavanaugh. We are a country that is based on the Constitution. I take an oath to the Constitution. That involves due process. It involves the presumption of innocence. And while I certainly believe that Professor Ford was a very sincere woman, there was no corroboration.
Well, I know there's a group of women, including some sexual abuse survivors, who wrote you a letter to ask you to vote against Kavanaugh. What do you say to those women?
I've said to them that they need to come forward with their stories, and that I hope through this process we've seen that more and more survivors are stepping forward, and that has to happen.
Let's switch over to gun control. What are your thoughts on the gun control right now?
Well, I'm a supporter of the Second Amendment, and I believe the laws need to be followed. We recently passed in the last year two bills. It was bipartisan support for these measures. One was, it's called Fix NICS, and it would help states to make sure that they are having people report, and you have those background checks to be able to take place, that you're in the system, the federal system, so that you can be checked. And another was to make sure that our schools are safe. After we've seen some of the shootings that happened, I convened a group here in Omaha. I had members of the education community come, local law enforcement, and I also had behavioral health people from UNMC come. And we really had a good discussion on what do we do? What do we do about this? And the focus was with this group is, first of all, how do you identify people that have issues, that have mental health issues, behavioral health issues? How can we make sure that they are identified? And then where do we go from here? The biggest issue, though, that we discussed was how do we keep kids safe at school? And that is making the school buildings safe, having training for teachers and students. And there was agreement in that group that these were the steps we needed to take.
Okay, budget talk. It's now surged to $779 billion, the highest it's been in 6 years. It's going to likely top maybe $1 trillion by 2019. How do we get spending under control?
I think we're on the way here. You know, this was the first year in decades, is my understanding, the first time in decades that the United States Senate took up spending bills. That's a big deal. You know, I come from the background of the Nebraska legislature where we took up appropriation bill every session. In the Senate, that wasn't happening. It takes 60 votes, we would be blocked, we couldn't get bills up. There was an agreement this last year that we needed to get on track to take up those spending bills and be able to debate them. And I thank Republicans and Democrats for agreeing on that we could take up these bills. We've passed 9 of them, and they were passed overwhelmingly. So hopefully, and that's 9 out of the 12, and then we have one that we just had a little minibus on. I mean, we can't continue to have these huge omnibuses come up at the end of the year where just a lot of pork is thrown into them, a lot of junk is thrown in. Those are really hard to vote for. It's not the way you should run a government. So hopefully now that we've gotten on track this year with taking up those spending bills, agreeing in a bipartisan way that this is what we need to do, it'll get us in that habit and we'll be able to follow up and do it again next year.
How do you feel about the federal government being required to have a balanced budget?
Well, we do it in Nebraska.
Right.
And it works.
Yeah.
And I did it for 8 years. Yeah. I did it for 8 years in Nebraska. I have no problem with that. I have sponsored every year I've been in the Senate. I have sponsored a balanced budget amendment.
It's just, are you getting the pushback from it, or why do you think there is an issue trying to make this happen?
It's hard to see change sometimes in Washington. You know, I'd mentioned my paid family leave bill earlier. I worked on that for 4 years and worked on it with Angus King, who's an independent from Maine. So we tried to build coalitions. We tried to get this done. I was able to get it in the tax reform bill. So things take a while. You know, back in the legislature again, I passed a highway funding bill. That was my fifth year as chairman of the Transportation Committee in the legislature to be able to get that policy passed and accomplished. So sometimes it takes a while to get some of those bigger, important policies done, but that doesn't mean you quit trying. You roll up your sleeves and you keep working on it, and if you can build those coalitions and bring people together, we can get it done.
All right, we're going to take a short break, but when we come back, we're going to talk tariffs and health care, defense. You're watching KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. Of KETV NewsWatch 7's Chronicle. Joining me this morning, Republican Senator Deb Fischer, who's running for re-election. So we talked a little bit about the economy, but not tariffs and the ones were imposed that on China. Do you find that these are hurting the U.S.?
They hurt segments of our economy. Of course they do. You know, and the president has heard from me about my concern on tariffs, especially for our ag producers, the steel tariffs that are in place. It hurts manufacturers. You know, here in Nebraska, we have center pivot factories here, the largest in the world that in production of center pivots. And that's putting a burden on them. But we also have a steel plant in Nebraska, so it's helping them. So what I think we need to do is have that balance. I can tell you that ag producers are very excited, though, about the trade deals that they're seeing happen now that the administration's working on. We have a deal with Mexico, one with Canada. People are feeling better about that. They feel more certainty. Talks opening with Japan. That's very, very important. A few weeks ago, the trade ambassador, Dowd, was here in Omaha, and I was able to bring together about 50 ag producers and ag business people here in Omaha to listen to him and ask him questions about what's going on with the trade agreements. And it was a very good discussion. In fact, later that day, I met with the ambassador from Japan and talked about the need to open this up, that that they would love our beef, that Nebraska beef. But just to be able to open up those agreements, and he was hopeful at the time. And of course, visiting with diplomats, you never know what that means, being hopeful at the time. But now those talks are open, and that's important. We have a deal with South Korea. I pushed the president on that over a year ago to make sure that we wouldn't lose our trade with South Korea, but also so we wouldn't lose a good ally in the region. I mean, I'm on the Armed Services Committee. I did not want to see South Korea look vulnerable in any way by us ending trade agreements just because of our military involvement there. With 30-some military men and women serving on that peninsula, we cannot weaken an ally in that regard. And now the administration is talking about having trade agreements with the EU. I think that's important. Ambassador Dowd talked about opening up discussions and having agreements in Southeast Asia. In Africa, they're working. I always say, you know, keep the good markets we have, but then let's open up and have opportunities for growth for our exports as well.
The president was just in the area earlier this month. He acknowledged a lot of elected officials, did not mention you. What's your relationship like with the president?
We have a good relationship. He is supportive of me. I can say that I'm able to talk to him when I need to. He returns phone calls. He's available always to have discussions. I was just at the White House a couple weeks ago with Senator Thune, Senator Grassley, Senator Ernst, and we were there to visit with the president before his announcement about year-round sale of E-15. I've had a bill on that for a year. I've been pushing it. And so to be able to convince the president that, you know, he could do some action on that, that would help our corn producers, help our ethanol plants here in this state, to be able to have that E-15 year-round sale, that was a huge deal to be able to do that. His administration is very open. My staff can call administrators in any of the agencies, their staff, to be able to ask questions that we get from Nebraskans. That's important to be able to have that openness. So when somebody in Nebraska asks a question, we can ask in Department of Ag or in the EPA or in the Commerce Department and reach somebody so we can get answers back here to Nebraska and get answers quickly.
Congress has yet to act on the Affordable Care Act. Where do we stand on that resolution? What's been some of the tie-ups?
Yeah, the tie-ups, it's political. Mm-hmm. You know, that's part of the frustrating part of dealing in Congress, is how political that is. But again, I try to always give a positive message to Nebraskans. I do. At my town halls that I have across the state, I think it's important that people see that Republicans and Democrats can work together. You don't always hear about that on the news, but we can work together, and we're doing that on some health issues. For example, on prescription drugs. I was in Hemingford, Nebraska, a couple years ago, and I went to the pharmacy there, a very small pharmacy, and the pharmacist told me that he could not tell people it was cheaper. It was cheaper for them to pay for their prescription out of pocket instead of using their copay. That was a gag clause, it was called. So there's a group of us who are working on issues like that, Republicans and Democrats. We got that bill passed, so that eliminates that gag clause now. The president signed it. We're also working on having more transparency on what procedures cost. You can go in now to an eye doctor and know what your LASIK surgery is going to cost, and you can compare it to somebody else. But you don't know, I always use this example, you don't know if it's cheaper for you to have an MRI on a Tuesday morning or on a Thursday afternoon. So we need to have more transparency. We need to have competitiveness come back. And it needs to be patients who can make these decisions on what's best for them and what they need.
Very limited time left. Let me answer this quickly. Defense budget-wise, where do we stand? Obviously, you know, military is a big part of Nebraska with Offutt right here. Yeah. Where are we standing right now? Are we spending enough?
Yeah. We are rebuilding our military. We have increased spending to our military. One of my priorities was to get that runway done at Offutt, and that is on schedule, and we are going to get it done. And to be able to take care of our men and women in the military, we've seen a salary increase for them the first time, oh goodness, in many, many years. We need to take care of those folks and their families. I am on a subcommittee, chairman of a subcommittee that has jurisdiction over STRATCOM, so that's extremely important to me. Nuclear modernization, missile defense, space as a war domain. That's what I have jurisdiction over. And so we have made sure to prioritize those areas and have worked on that to make sure that the funding is available there so that we can continue to have a really strong deterrence in this country, because it keeps us safe and it keeps the world safe.
All right. We'll be right back with some final thoughts, including why Senator Deb Fischer wants your vote this November. First reminder, your comments are an important part of the show. If you'd like to be heard, email your comments to news@ketv.com. We love hearing from you. We'll be right back. This is KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. Today we've been talking with incumbent Republican Senator Deb Fischer. And as we do with all our candidates, we're going to give you a minute to make a final pitch to the voters.
Thank you. Well, it's been an honor to serve you in the United States Senate. In the past 6 years, I've visited with tens of thousands of Nebraskans. You've invited me into your homes and your communities. I've held hundreds of community coffees, town halls, business, medical, educational roundtables. And together, we've gotten a lot of things done. We've cut taxes. We're rebuilding our military. We passed the first ever paid family leave bill in the history of Congress. We're cutting regulations, and we're making life easier for Nebraskans. I love working for you in the Senate. I take you with me to Washington every single day. And what I would like to do is to continue to fight for you in the Senate, continue to work for families. I thank you for your partnership, your support, and I humbly ask for your vote.
All right, Senator Deb Fischer, thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate
thank
your time.
You.
And remember, if you missed any part of the interview or the ones we did with Democrat Jane Raybould and Libertarian Jim Schultz, they're both online at ketv.com. Go to our homepage, click on the menu button, and look for Chronicle. That's also where you'll find the interviews we did with second congressional candidates Don Bacon and Kara Eastman. I'm John Oakey. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here next Sunday morning for more Chronicle.